Well, San Diego Employment Attorney Ward Heinrichs, Esquire, is back on Big Blend Radio today to talk about harassment in the hospitality and tourism industries. And Ward is a regular Big Blend Radio guest and contributor to Big Blend Radio and TV Magazine. And you can see his articles and listen to his past interviews. Just go to blendradioandtv.com and click into the expert department. But, you know, since we've opened up the doors on tourism and hospitality content in our Parks and Travel magazine, he is also writing in there now talking about laws that pertain to those industries. And his first article coming up in the February and March issue of Parks and Travel magazine is all about harassment in restaurants, hotels, and bars. And he's going to be joining us now to talk all about that. And if you want to see his article, it's also up already if you go to nationalparktraveling.com. And I encourage you to go to his website because you can go and listen to his podcast and read his articles. And you may need to hire him if you're in San Diego, whether you're an employer or an employee. So go to bestemploymentattorneysandiego.com. He's also, you'll find him on Facebook and Twitter at Ward Heinrichs. Ward, welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm doing very well, Lisa. How are you guys doing?
We're doing good. We're doing good. We're really glad to hear your voice. It took a little time getting you on here. We had some glitches on the show, but we're rolling ahead now, so that's good. But harassment, that is not a little glitch. This is a big deal, talking about what's going on, obviously, in the entertainment industry. But, you know, when we saw the Me Too wave on social media, it was like pretty much every woman from every walk of life was talking about it and still are.
Yeah, I mean, obviously we've seen in the news that it's really come to a head and is capturing the headlines all over the place and continuing to do so even today. And it's not just restricted to those areas we see in the news, you know, the politicians and other media and Hollywood, but it's alive in other places too. And in fact, I did some internet research for this article and came across the name of Anthony Bourdain, and I've watched his show before. He does a great several shows that run on various cable outlets, and he's funny, he's good, but you know, he's edgy. And he wrote a book celebrating the edginess of the kitchen. And he's since actually made an apology for that. He said, boy, if I'd known that I had fostered this type of atmosphere, I would have done something differently to begin with. So the point I'm making is kitchen, you know, in restaurants has had some problem. It's been outlined and written about by some famous people, and it's been investigated by undercover reporters too. And so that is an area where there seems to be some issues.
You know, it's interesting. I actually read Kitchen Confidential, and I was like, damn, you know, things are going on kitchen tables that you shouldn't, you know. Then the next thing you know, people are getting served from there. That's like, no, thank you. That book was like crazy, you know. But there is that same, you know, when you look at that, what happens with, you know, the kitchen area and the bar area, and musicians are tied into that too, because I know, just as being a musician and having chef friends and restaurant friends and clubs and bar friends, that, you know, at midnight or 1 in the morning when everyone else is stumbling home, this whole other thing starts to happen, and it's like they're all hanging out, and it's time for cocktails then, and that seems to be a thing. I think that there's this late shift cocktail time, and then things, one thing leads to another.
Well, yeah, that, I mean, the theme that I've seemed to see in these industries is men and women working closely together in a more loose work setting. You know, if you're working in a factory, it's pretty well governed. If you're working in an office, you know, there's less opportunity for that kind of thing to go on. But here, you know, there's just a lot of rushing around, and then there is that, like you said, the tendency to maybe do a little partying after the day is done. And I don't think you see it quite as much in other industries. So I think that's a good insight.
Yeah, because I know that lots of restaurant owners, bar owners in particular, give their employees like a free drink at the end of the shift.
Bars,
offices don't really do that. Yeah, so it's kind of a Like, maybe that's not a good policy. What do you think?
Well, you know my opinion on alcohol. I've talked about it on the holiday party reviews
yeah.
that we've done in the past. And it just creates potential workplace problems. And so I say do not foster it. I don't think it's going to benefit you. Now, you know, I shouldn't
yeah.
say that. The benefit is people like it. And it can keep your employees happier. But the problem with alcohol is it reduces the inhibitions. And depending on how much you drink, it could drastically reduce them and get you into some trouble. So for that reason, I think maybe other benefits are more appropriate. Other small gifts, you know, whatever it is. And that way you don't have the downside of the alcohol.
Right. And the other thing, too, when you look at this, I was just thinking back to, you know, watch what your employer is doing. You've talked about on shows before on hospitality about tipping, and I know that stuff could change soon, right? From what I was hearing, that tipping could go away. I don't know what's happening with that, but I was thinking Mario Batali, who's friends with Anthony Bourdain, was in trouble for like taking his employees' tips or something like that. It wasn't too long ago, and then, bam, right after that, in trouble for sexual harassment. Same thing as the Me Too thing came out on him. And I'm like, you know, I just go like, how does it kind of, if you have an employer maybe, you know, looking from the employee side and they start doing something wrong in one area, it could mean that it's going to happen, you know, in that area too. You know, it's, you got to, I think as an employee now, you have to, you know, interview your potential employer to make sure you're not working for someone who can harm you.
Well, that's interesting. You know, there are some types of interviews where that probably happens more often than in other types of interviews. I think mostly people just want to get a job because they want to make some money. Now, I think higher up the rung you go, you know, CEO, things like that, then, yeah, I think there is a two-way interview more. But honestly, I don't think it happens too much on your average job.
Okay, so now let's go into what can businesses do. And I do want to get into what happens also with farm workers because that's tied into our food and into restaurants and even tourism because there's a huge thing with agritourism. So let's talk about what can we do as a business owner, what, you know, hotel, restaurant, bar. What are some of the things we can look at to protect ourselves from, you know, landing up in a situation that can disrupt work, you know, this kind of thing too. And obviously if someone gets sexually harassed, it's you know, devastating for them.
Yeah, because of the climate that we're in, I think we're going to see an uptick in sexual harassment cases filed. And in fact, I think I've seen more of those come across my desk in one way or the other. And so I think just people are more sensitive to it. So I think it's very important that employers do the right things to try to correct the situation. If it needs to be corrected, at least investigate it. And so at the very least, and in California it's required, you need to have a sexual harassment policy that's written. And it's normally in a handbook. It doesn't have to be in a handbook, but it should be a written policy. So you start there, and it should be strongly worded that, you know, we just don't tolerate this. And then you got to follow up with it, though. You got to show that you don't tolerate it as well. And, of course, there's the sexual harassment posters that are supposed to be posted in visible places in the workplace. So that's another requirement in California, and you just need to do it. And the reason why you need to do these things, if you do these basic things, that are, you know, the writings, the posters, then if you get investigated for a claim of sexual harassment, you can say, hey, look, I'm doing these things. And then, you know, if there is a complaint, you need to follow up on it and do an investigation and do it quickly. Now, you know, different investigations are going to turn up different things. Doesn't mean that you necessarily have to fire anyone. You might even find that, well, that's not truly sexual harassment. I know that some companies, if even for a claim, they really tend to fire people who have a claim against them, whether it's strongly supported or not. So some companies take a very defensive position on it. I hate to see it overused, and I like to see it used fairly. So certainly the investigation is important, and then you come to the right, you know, the conclusion that seems to come to a conclusion and then follow up on the necessary punishment or counseling or whatever it is.
Yeah, these investigations, are they confidential? Or, I mean, I know if the person making the claim goes to the break room and tells everybody, obviously it's not going to be confidential. But from the management point of view, or the owner, because that's what the break room's about. You know, you get to hear scandal.
Water cooler talk, that's right there.
But, you know, so, I mean, do you think, is there something in the management level and the ownership level that would say you need to keep this confidential?
I think that's an important thing to include in your policy because you want to make the – now, it's not required by the law, but you want to make the person who is making the complaint as comfortable as possible. And confidentiality goes a long way to doing that. But, of course, the obvious problem is, well, you can't keep it completely confidential. There, you know, there's really hardly any way because, like you said, maybe someone's running their mouth anyway. And someone's going to have to investigate, and they're going to have to probably talk to several witnesses. So all those people are going to be alerted that something's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And then further, then there is a report. Well, not in all cases. Sometimes it's done orally, and I think that's appropriate in certain circumstances. But I think if it's a serious enough matter, it certainly should be done in writing. An investigation writing should be done. And it doesn't have to be handed over to the person who made the request. In fact, there's ways of protecting that, and it might be a good thing for the company to do that. But if there is a writing, that would probably be seen by more than one person. And again, so there's a limitation on confidentiality when that type of thing happens. But at all levels, no matter who's talked to, they should all be told that, you know, we want you to keep this confidential. And so if that's said enough times throughout the investigation, the chances of it being confidential are greater. Now, again, you can't stop people from blabbing. People may do it anyway, but at least you've done your best.
What about the situation where an employee is put – we were talking to some hotel staff a while back, and we were talking about some of the hotel experiences, which are pretty bizarre. When the cleaning crew comes in, is there somebody in the room or not? And do they need to be in the room alone, especially as a woman? You walk in to clean the room, and there's a man there, and he's naked in bed and tells you to come on in anyway. All kinds of weird stories. I mean, it makes your hair rise up. It's really bad. Some of the things we've heard from hotel staff. So what is the, how does an employer – can the employer be sued for not having a safe working place through something like that? Or how do you handle something like that where the girls going to clean the rooms can feel safe?
Well, you know, in that particular situation, I don't know how often it happens, but if it's a regular occurrence, certainly then the employer is on notice. And that's the real key with these third-party claims of sexual harassment. California law clearly protects employees and requires the employer to have, you know, essentially a safe workplace, a place that is free of harassment. And that goes for all employees or employers in California. Even if you employ one person, you can have a sexual harassment charge against you. In other discrimination types of cases, it has to be five or more employees. So everyone in California who employs someone is exposed to this. And the most often what you see is harassment done by either a coworker or a supervisor. Supervisor is called strict liability. That means if it happens, there's liability, and it just depends on how much. And now, of course, you have to prove that it happens, but if you do, then there's liability. Coworkers are different. And the same thing is – and there's the same difference with third-party harassers. Maybe an independent contractor comes in and delivers meat, and there's a woman there who receives the meat into the location. And that third-party independent contractor harasses her. the only way that can become a claim is if the business is on notice that it happened. And the same thing with a coworker. The business has to be on notice that it's going on. So that's why it's important for people who feel harassed to report these things. So if they don't report them, maybe mm-hmm. the business doesn't know, and then they're not going to be on the hook at all. And the other part of that is, rather than just making them potentially liable, is to alert them to a problem that they can cure. That's mm-hmm. hopefully that's where this all goes. Is that, you know, we're taking this seriously. We're trying to make the workplace friendlier and fairer. And when something like this is reported, we investigate and do the right thing based on what the investigation requires. So that, you know, everyone's trying to make it better, not just protect from liability. Now, of course, you do have to protect from liability, and the same policies would apply. They help you make the workplace better. They help protect you better. So both things are promoted.
I think if I owned a hotel, that I would never allow a cleaning staff person to go into a room alone
mm-hmm.
ever.
Yeah,
I think I would, you know, just have two girls go in, or you know, whatever it is, so that you never run into the mm-hmm. you know, thing where a girl's in the room alone with some guy that she doesn't know, and
mm-hmm.
You know, it's a problem, and you could make the work go faster that way. Two can clean faster
yeah.
than one, so I guess I would probably take that out. None of my girls would go into rooms alone ever.
And keep the door open, which is also a security risk for the guests. But, yeah, there's also that, you know. I think that, you know, it is Friday, Ward, and I think we need to give you a hot toddy. I'm just saying, since we're talking about bars and hotels and restaurants.
Sounds good.
A hot toddy. I know. I mean, it's really interesting.
I do have a cold.
I know, that's what I'm saying. You need a toddy. We can hear that a little bit. So we hope you feel better, you know. So get, you know, it's the weekend. You're not allowed to be cold, have a cold. That's rude. It's not allowed. It's not allowed for Wardies in San Diego. And you are in, like, the capital of hospitality in San Diego and tourism. I mean, that's a major part of San Diego's economy is tourism, you know. And
it is.
It really is.
Certainly is.
Yeah, it's a
lot of hotels out there.
Man, I love San Diego. It's one of the best cities ever.
Mm-hmm.
It really is. It's, you know, people got to go hang out there and party and go out to the beach and out to the mountains. It's a cool place. So the other thing, too, so, you know, we've got to protect, you know, workers from guests, you know, whether it's a restaurant or a bar, right? Because that's the other thing.
Mm-hmm.
Patrons can get naughty, you know.
Yeah, they can't, especially in
mm-hmm.
bars.
And the other thing, at some point I want to talk about, what about bartenders? I know this isn't harassment, but I'm just thinking that down the road we got to talk about this, because calling, you know, cabs, whose fault is it if you know, someone drives off? Does it land on a bartender's? I was just thinking about that when they're too drunk or something. I want to cover that because it's important. You know, there's all of that education that goes into it. But you're saying that really you're seeing that you think that there's going to be more training involved and people need to start working, you know, towards that. Do you advise your clients to just start doing the training now? I know last time you were on the show, you were saying, like, everybody should be involved in the training, not just the supervisors.
Yeah. Now, there is a law in California that's requiring training for all agricultural workers.
Mm-hmm.
So that law is already in place for that industry. It's wise in all industries now. I just think this has become such a huge thing and such a liability
mm-hmm.
risk.
Mm-hmm.
That everyone – and that also shows any investigator that comes in from an outside agency, hey, I'm not just doing the minimum. I'm training everyone. And honestly, it doesn't even cost that much more, because if you're training, you know, 5, 10, 15 supervisors, it's not that much more to train, you know, 50 or 100 people in it's going to be a larger room, but it's going to be the same exercise.
Mm-hmm.
So – you're not going to pay the trainer much more or any more, probably. And so it's just, to me, now, you know, there's downtime. Certainly there would be downtime in that. Certainly, if it's not downtime, if it's outside of hours, you have to pay people. So there is that expense. There's no doubt about that. But it just seems to me that in this current climate we're in, that that's just a wise thing to do. So I really think that employers should consider that seriously.
Yeah, and I think you would probably keep your employees longer mm-hmm. if you can manage to keep bad things from happening. But how do you put a dollar amount when, okay, somebody comes to you and they, you know, been a victim of sexual harassment in the workplace, how do you decide what action to take? I mean, as far as if you're going to go to court and you're going to ask for money, how do you figure out what to ask for, what to claim?
Well, I mean, that's just a basic exercise attorneys go through if they're mm-hmm. do any litigation. And you take in the facts, and you have some experience probably in the same type of facts and what the value was may have derived from previous cases. And then you also can look up jury verdicts. You can also look up arbitration awards and match the facts as close as you can to the facts that you have. And those are rules of thumb as well. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's a process through which you go. And some of it depends on what the client really wants. Sometimes the client doesn't really want to make a claim or file a claim. What they really want is maybe to ask for some severance. And so, you know, then you'd approach that a little differently. You go, okay, well, you know, you don't want to expose yourself to the anxiety of litigation, which I totally get. I mean, litigation is not fun for the people who are involved in it. So, you know, that would probably reduce the value because of that position, but it may be a good way for them to get on with their life and correct mm-hmm. the problem.
If,
so various
if
things
you
go
are,
into that.
Yeah, if you're involved in a lawsuit and you move on to a different job or attempting to get a new job, is this part of something that would maybe have employers, oh, I don't think I'm going to hire you? Because you took your other boss to court. I mean, would they
well,
know?
Possibly find out. You know, there's a check the box rule in California and other states now that says you can't require someone to disclose criminal convictions until after you've given them a solid job offer. But the same isn't true for all prior litigation. So it's certainly possible for an employer to do a background check and find, you know, lawsuits or something else in someone's history. And yeah, I mean, honestly, sure, that could have an effect. I think it depends on the situation, and it depends on what the employer finds out. I mean, you don't have to disclose it, but, you know, it could come up one way or the other.
Wow. It's amazing, man. It's just how much, you know, when you think about going into business, how much you have to think of. And then just as, mm-hmm. as employees, you have to watch yourself. You know, to me, I think it's, you always have to look at where you're going, and, you know, it's difficult. It's difficult.
I think it's confusing because it's, okay, what's against the law and what isn't? And if being an idiot at work and pinching people's butts is not against the law, or is it? Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think people know what's mm-hmm. against the law, what isn't, what is bad behavior, and then what your employer expects out of you is different than what the law says you can or cannot do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I think it's a confusing area.
It is. There's a lot of gray area, and it's interesting that you brought up the pinching butts thing. So let's run with that a little bit.
Man.
It certainly can be.
A lot of salesmen, and that's what they do.
They pinch butts.
They pinch butts in the break room.
So that's sort of thing.
So
in the
then
kitchen.
You learn to take your break outside.
Okay. Well, now you know.
That's true.
Pinching butts is actually that's battery. So that's actually a crime.
Oh,
and,
really?
You know, yeah, sure it is. Battery's offensive contact. So there's that aspect of it. Now, let's say the person who's doing the pinching is pinching men and women. Now, the problem with that is, all right, it's battery against everyone. But it may not be discriminatory because they're doing it to everyone. And there are lots of cases that talk about that where the boss is a jerk to a woman, says, the boss was a jerk to me, called me a bitch, did all this stuff. And you go, wow, that's pretty bad. But then you learn in the litigation that he does that to men too. And then the court said, you don't have a case.
But remember the scene that segment on Friends, the TV show? And Chandler Bing, the guy, every time they'd go out of a meeting, he would whack him on the butt.
Yes,
and then, like, he complained about it. And then everybody else was getting whacked on the butt, and he got all depressed because it's like, I want my butt whacking back.
No, that's just assault then. That
is
assault. Wow.
Well, you know, it's weird. It is. These kind of things are so weird, and you don't know whether to say anything. Is it worth it? You know, and you have to look at that. And when I was, 19 or whatever, 19 when we got back to this country, and I worked in the restaurant industry, and I couldn't believe this guy, you know, I was left alone, and, because we both sang. And so we'd sing, like, getting everything closed up. Didn't think this would lead to anything. And, butt pinching, just slap you on the butt or just give you, it's like when someone walks by and they give you a squeeze, on the side. And I was like, dude, what are you doing, man? And I'm like, what are you doing? And then he tried to kiss me, and I was like, okay, that's it. I'm out of here. And instead of going to the boss, I left and got a new job. I got a new job, like, the next day and quit. And she's like, well, I wish you had told me something. I'm like, really? He's your head guy. What are you going to do? I just got here. You're really going to, that's how I felt at that time. And I just, went out and, at this point I knew this wasn't going to be my big career of life. So I think that's a lot of – these guys never get caught because people just move on. And you have to. At that point we just got here. I need to put food on the table, So it was like, I don't have time for that.
No, because you're right. I think that happens quite a bit, that, someone just says, hey, it's just not worth it. And, And there's even in the law, it says, well, if it's one incident, maybe you don't have a case. Of course, it depends on how bad the incident is. So one incident probably doesn't create a huge liability situation for the employee and employer. And so that means it's not a very big case for the employee. And is it worth it? In so many cases, I'm sure the answer is to the person who's been subjected to that is no. It's not worth it, so they move on. I think that probably does happen quite a bit. I'm sure it happens more often than a case is filed. I'm really sure of that.
Yeah,
so, people don't want to do that. Now, it's interesting that you brought up friends, because you remember I talked about the friends case some years ago?
Yeah.
Where there was body talk in the writing room, and the idea it was that it was creative, and so the woman who filed the case was thrown out of court because, number one, she was on notice that it was happening, and number two, it was part of the creative process. Now, something interesting in the restaurant industry is it seems there was an investigative reporter, I think her last name was McMillan, and she did a couple different types of jobs trying to investigate sexual harassment. And she said that she actually, on the last day of job, was subject to it. But up until that point, she had played tough, bantered back, engaged in the activity of the body language and behavior. So if you do that as a woman, you hurt your chances, and maybe drastically, of getting of winning a case or even getting a case filed. I think that puts a woman in a difficult situation. You're in an industry where this kind of stuff goes on, so you have to take one of two tacks. One, I'm going to be cold and aloof, or two, I'm going to engage and be part of the crowd. But when I do that, now it doesn't seem unwanted. And that's one of the things about harassment. It has to be unwanted. If you want it, then it's legal.
Yeah.
So,
well, it's weird because people do get that little thing at work, like, ooh, there's like little relationships that happen, right?
And then you have to
pretend you're not doing it, but you're doing it, or having a relationship, either one, quite frankly, and you're trying to hide it. And then suddenly you realize, like, maybe you're dating someone you really don't like, and then the woman may say something. You know what I mean? I mean, I remember dating someone, I went out on a date with a guy from work. I should never have done this. This was years ago.
Yeah.
And I think I just turned 21.
And
we stopped at my house real quick on the way somewhere. I came out, and he had taken a hot dog bun out of my refrigerator and put his pee-pee in it. And I'm like, what are you doing? Get out. And then I had to go face him the next day. And he's best friends with my boss. What do you do? A I say, listen, did you know this dude did this? And he's like, well, so? And I'm like, dude, and
no,
this is the same boss that licked your hand, Nancy.
Yeah, I know.
And,
see,
so
and that whole company
was corrupt. It's
company,
riddled.
Oh, my gosh.
Sorry. It was a really weird company, and they had stores all over the place. And there, whenever something happened, and something was always happening because it was mostly
you could
musicians.
Write a book.
Yeah, it was pretty funny, actually. The guys at the top, the answer was always, well, boys will be boys.
I know.
That's
and I'm
exactly
like, yes, with hot dog buns, they will.
Yeah.
That was the craziest thing. I was just like, okay, don't date your you know, colleagues. Do not do that. That was the first lesson. And, yeah, I learned.
Yeah, no, that's probably a good policy, and that, I mean, wow, I don't know if that's I have to say, Lisa, that is a funny story, and I'm feeling guilty for thinking it's funny.
You know, I
called
Nancy.
Oh, my gosh.
I called Nancy, and I'm like, dude, you're never going to believe what Kyle did.
Yeah.
And she goes, yes, I do, I told you.
Yeah.
I told you.
And then her boss, which came, because we were in different stores, because they didn't want to put us together because we might be trouble. And so her boss came to my store, and he took my hand when saying hello, you're Lisa's mom, and then he licked it.
Yeah.
So I hit him. As he licked my hand, I just hit him in the face with my hand, like, get off. What are you doing? In front of everybody, and nothing happened to either one of us. You know, it's like, the whole culture of that company was so bizarre.
But it's entertainment, and I think the food industry is like that. And when you're in the kitchen, everybody's swearing. Everybody's already in that zone. There's this hot, and it's the same in the music industry.
Yeah.
I mean, it just is going to – something's going to happen. And I think that the training is always that little reminder, you know, and then everybody's looking around the room going, are they talking to me? You know what I mean? So it's like one of those things. You have to do, and I think, do the posters really work, putting up all these posters, it's a safety guard for the owner
for
of
the
company,
owner.
Right?
That's what it really is. I mean, it's required by the law, and so, you know, do the employees need more information on a poster than they already have? Probably not. It probably doesn't affect that at all, but it is, like you said, a safety a way of protecting the employer because they're following the law. So, you just have to do it. You just have to do it, even though it, you know, does it really make a difference? I don't know. I would venture not a huge difference.
It reminds people, maybe, you know, like wash your hands before you go back.
Yeah, it can be a reminder. Yeah,
you know, they're kind of like, do I do this? Having a manual, I think having regular things where it's always in your face, like we are a conscious company on it. It's just like drugs, drug testing. You know, that same company kept knocking on my door for drug testing because I kept passing, you know. But the first time I almost didn't think I would. But anyway, that's a whole other story. But anyhow, that's going to be our next conversation, Ward. I know everyone, Ward will be back on the show January 24th talking about weed. California, it's legal for recreation. It's now you can do it. But it's not like you could just walk in and start lighting up everywhere, and it does change a little bit for employment law, and things can start happening. So it's going to be an interesting year, Ward, unless Jeff Sessions
gets his way
and bans the whole thing everywhere because it's state
federal
again. I know. If he does that, Colorado's going to be mad. So California.
Well, I mean, the bottom line on that is if it's illegal under federal law, and if the feds want to enforce it, and pretty much they haven't in California. I mean, we've had medical marijuana for years, and there really has been very little federal enforcement. But if the feds want to, they can, and we'll see.
Yeah.
Now, you know what I heard though recently was that that Sessions said the local attorney generals can apply that law the way they want to. So. A statement came out from the one in San Diego and said, well, you know, we're going to continue doing things the way we've done them. So that means, you know, not much.
Wow.
I think California is going to disengage from the rest of the
country. It's time to succeed. I don't know. It's going to be interesting.
It's going to be its own country.
I know, man. Your office is going to be like, it's going to be all these different cases with harassment and weed. It's going to be like one after the other. I'm just kidding, Ward. I don't know.
You know, sometimes people use things like alcohol, I can't help it, I was drunk, and then they get off, you know.
Yeah.
Like, oh, okay.
Yeah, no, there's too many, there are way too many puns flying around in this conversation already. I'm just saying. Oh, man. So, Ward, listen, get better this weekend. You're not allowed to get a cold. You have to come back on our show January 24th, so we got to talk about weed. So we're excited about that. That's fun. It's a fun topic.
Okay, sounds good. I'm ready.
I know. Everybody, again, I got to go to bestemploymentattorneysandiego.com, and he's also on Twitter at Ward Heinrichs. You can keep up with Ward there. And his articles, just go to blendradioandtv.com. You'll see Ward in our expert department. Again, he's going to be featuring this article in our March issue of Parks and Travel magazine, but it's already up on the website at nationalparktraveling.com. Just type in Ward, you'll find it. And thank you so much for joining us, Ward, and for waiting. Apparently, there's a server issue because New York is having these major power outages, so that's what's going on with our show today. I was wondering what's going on. I'm like, try everything under the sun, but we're here. You made it on, and we still got to play our Crazy Little Liar song earlier. So we have a song for you, though. It is called, if I get it completely off air here, it's called Bar Band, because I figured it ties into what we're talking about, right? And you got a lot of bar bands in San Diego. You got a good music scene in San Diego. And this is from our friend the Tall Men Group, who do play in San Diego and L.A. And so it's off of their first album, 12 by 6. But thank you so much for joining us, Ward. Happy Friday.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you. And you guys have a great weekend as well.
All right. We'll talk to you soon. Take care. Here it
okay.
is, everyone.
Bye.
Bar Band.
Times get hard, the music would see me through. So I played and I